So let's talk about switches. In any system, you have to get your toggles in the right positions if you want everything to run smoothly. And language is no exception. When you acquire one, you have to make all these decisions about how that language works. But then, when you go and learn a new one, are those switches going to stay frozen in place? Nope, you can still happily flip to your heart's content. I'm O.T. Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
When we learn a second language, there is a lot to pick up. What sounds it uses, what words it has, and how it makes them. All the ways it crafts its sentences and transforms them into meanings. Fortunately, we know a fair amount about how languages can work already. We transfer over everything that we know about our first language, or L1, and that works as the base from which we can build our new language, or L2. And it really is everything. When you learn an L2, the entire grammar, your whole knowledge base about your L1 gets moved. Included in that are all your parameter settings. Parameters are the ways in which languages can differ one to the next. Do you move your question words when you ask things, or do you just leave them where they are? Do you always need a subject, or can you leave them out when it's clear from the context what you're talking about? Do you use stress in your words or not? Those are all things that you had to learn when you acquired your L1, and so to start out, it's all stuff that gets transferred over to the L2. But because that's the stuff that varies between languages, if you want to speak as native-like as possible in your L2, you're going to have to flip a lot of these switches over. For a long time, though, that was a big part of the debate in linguistics. Can you actually reset those parameters, or are you ultimately stuck on whatever you had for your L1? Well, it could be that whether you can reset is different if you're a kid versus an adult. After all, kids have an easier time acquiring language in general, and particularly those deeper grammatical points that they can just pick up intuitively. As it happens, those usually map to parameters, so even if we see transfer from the L1, it looks like kids should be able to subconsciously pick up those parameter differences and flip the switches, no problem. But does that actually happen? Let's take a look at a case study of a Turkish boy named Erdem who moved to the UK when he was 4. When he first started meeting with the linguist to look at his English, he'd only spent 3 months in the UK, of which 2 were spent mostly at home in a Turkish language environment. He'd only been immersed in English at a nursery school for a month or so. So, really, that's not much English exposure yet. What could we expect to find? Here's the thing. Turkish and English differ in headedness, or the placement of a head of a syntactic phrase with respect to its complement. Take a sentence like, "Cat could not stop Annie from cheating." Since English is head initial, that means the tense, could, comes before its complement, the negation not. Stop shows up before its object, Annie. The preposition from appears before cheating, etc. That's how English works. First you get the head, and then the complement. Turkish, on the other hand, works exactly the other way around. The head always shows up after the complement. So Erdem, when he was just starting out in English, was making the assumption that it works that way too. In the first times he met with the researcher, he said things like, "I something eating," and "finish no," where the head comes last. The verb in the first sentence and the negation in the second show up at the end. But English is amazingly full of evidence that it's head initial. Every sentence that you hear where the verb comes before the object, or a noun before a preposition, is one more piece of data to tell you that English is the opposite of Turkish. So maybe it's not a huge surprise that Erdem worked this out without too much difficulty. But here's the thing, he did it basically immediately. Sure, through the first handful of sessions that he had in the first 3 months, whenever he spoke in English, he went for that Turkish head final setting. But suddenly, in month 4, his system flipped, and he was making regular head initial English sentences, like, "you eating apple," or, "I not eat cornflake." He might not have had the grammar quite right yet, but he clearly had worked headedness out. He very reliably used the English setting, just like flipping a switch. The thing is, maybe we'd expect kids to be able to pull off learning new settings more easily. After all, kids are amazing at soaking up new languages and implicitly knowing what they need to do to match the community around them. But for adults, it's often more challenging to pull that off. Is that kind of parameter resetting just for kids, or can adults do it too? Let's take a look at another word order variation between languages to address that question. In languages like English and Chinese, verbs stay down in the verb phrase. So in a sentence like "Jones does not age much," the verb "age" stays below "not," which is the negation. But some languages, like French or Japanese, have verbs that itch to move up in the tree. In a normal sentence, verbs in those languages move up to the tense position in IP. So, the same sentence in French would be "Jones vieillit pas beaucoup." And you can see the verb "vieillit" is before the negation "pas," so it must have moved up. Or how about this? Both English and French can create yes-no questions by moving the tense up before the subject. Now, English sticks a "do" in for that, like, do the fairies go to school? And the verb stays low. But because French moves the verb for tense, it's there when you want to move it for the question. So like, vont les fées à l'école? All of those are because of the parametric difference in how strongly the sentence wants that verb in the tense position. Okay, so can adult L2 learners reset this parameter and stick their verbs in the right place? Well, one researcher looked at French learners of English by using a task that got them to create these questions themselves, and found that out of over 1,100 questions posed by these L2 English speakers, all but two of them had the English word order, without the French-style verb raising. And in a preference ranking task with the same participants, the L2 learners consistently rejected sentences with French-style negation or questions in English, such as, the court likes not the forest, or likes Jean's swordplay, so they look like they flipped to the English setting. A separate study looked at how English and French speakers place their adverbs in Chinese, in which the verb stays low, meaning adverbs come before it. But no matter their L1, the L2 learners get their adverb placement right. They both accept and produce sentences like this one, which means coyote often watches humans, but don't produce or accept sentences like this one, with the verb and adverb flipped. So like, coyote watches often humans. That might be the right word order in other languages, like French, but even French native speakers know the Chinese doesn't behave like that. So does that mean that L2 speakers can just flip any parameter they want? Well, maybe not. Sometimes the data in the L2, compared to your L1 setting, won't let you flip to a native-like position, as we'll talk about back on the website. But it also may be that some things are just outright unflippable. Like, let's look at stress. If you're in a language like English, Portuguese, or Ukrainian, you use stress in your words, but if you're a French or Turkish speaker, you don't. All you do in French and Turkish is make the end of the phrase a bit stronger to mark when you're done. But there's no regular word-level stress that needs to be learned. That means that if you want to sound native-like in Turkish, you have to get rid of your stress if you have it. And a study from 2012 looked at whether that was possible. French speakers who didn't have stress to begin with didn't have any problems getting the Turkish system. English speakers, though, couldn't quite pull it off. Even as they made closer and closer approximations of what Turkish sounds like, they still had stress in their words in a way that the French and Turkish speakers didn't. So maybe for something fundamental to phonology like stress, you're just stuck. But overall, when we move into a new language, we're perfectly capable of working out the ways in which our native tongue differs from it. Making the sentences match the L2 parameters is usually well within our grasp. All we have to do is reach into our minds and flip those switches. So we've reached the end of the Ling Space for this week. If you followed my word order, you learned that when we acquire a new language, we need to change the parameter settings from our L1 to match our L2. That both children and adults are able to change these properties to match the new language once they have enough data, and that some things, like phonological stress, can prove perhaps too much to reset if they're in your L1. The Ling Space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman. It's directed by Delélise Prévost, and it's written by both of us. Our editor is Georges Coulomb, our production assistant is Stéphane Hurtubise, our music is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below! Or you can bring the discussion back over to our website, where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Also, while you're there, try dropping by our store, where we have a bunch of cool linguistics stuff. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal link space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Ausdenk, Pingsang!